pleased to have a return visit of Lee Kennard from the University of Oklahoma, who will talk on topological realization and geometric models.
Okay. Thank you very much for having me back. I talked a few years ago. It wasn't too terrible, I suppose. Let me start with the title just again. Mostly it's about topological realization problems. But also, I'll discuss what I mean by geometric models. Probably everyone in this room has worked on some version of what I'm about to talk about. So this is nothing. I grabbed my mouth. These are pretty basic questions, and part of it's kind of embarrassing that I don't know the answer. So if you feel like you might know a reference or somebody who might know the answer, I'm really interested in these. I'm gonna pose a few questions throughout that are pretty naive and might be easy, but so far I don't know the answer yet. So to start, I'm gonna discuss ZP cohomology, and I mean Z mod PZ, okay. And the motivation here comes from the Hopf invariant 1 problem. So this is a famous problem. And the setup is like this. You assume you have a CW complex such that I want to talk about Z2 cohomology ring is a singly generated polynomial algebra. And you can ask truncated or not. I'll consider this case where it's truncated at this order. So the generators are degree 0, degree d. I'll put a little subscript d, okay? So d is the degree of the generator. And then its square is also non-zero, all right? You get such a thing, let me see what the theorem is, then remind you what this has to do with Hopf invariant 1. The theorem, sort of the theorem before the theorem was due to Edem, as in the Edem relations, or Steenrod squares. So sometime in the 50s, we showed that if you have any CW complex with this simple-looking homology with Z2 coefficients, then the degree has to be a power of 2. Right. So if you know anything about Steenrod squares, you know that they decompose if the degree is not a power of 2, and that's basically all you need for this statement. All right, this is, you know, something you can find in Hatcher. This theorem is not so well known, though, because Adams proved a lot more. This is in his 1960 paper where he solved the Hopf invariant 1 problem. He says, not only is d a power of 2, but it's is 1 allowed? Yeah, so 1, 2, 4, or 8, all right? And this theorem is sharp because if you take any one of the Hopf vibrations and build a CW complex using it, you get this. So I'll say, for example, if you take the Hopf vibration from S3 to S2, this is some kind of interesting, non-trivial map. So this is the Hopf vibration. This induces this CW complex where you just start with an N sphere and you attach a 2N disk. What's N? N is just 2. Excuse me. S2, and you attach a 4 disk using this map from the boundary to S2. And you know, the fact that this is somehow geometrically interesting suggests that this is geometrically interesting, and when you compute the homology, this is true even integrally. Of course, there's S7 to S4, and S15 to S8, and There's also the one corresponding to RP1. Yeah, so this is like CP2. This is a CW structure for CP2. We have all of the four projected planes coming up here. So one theorem I want to advertise, this was something I showed in my thesis, was a generalization of Adam's theorem. And I'll explain in a minute what the motivation for the assumption I'm about to give you is. So the theorem is like this. You have a CW complex, and you assume that there exists a non-zero element x. Am I using x? Yeah. Non-zero element x in degree d with z2 coefficients, such that multiplication maps. So this is just usual cup product. D is the degree such that these maps are isomorphisms for all possible degrees. So if this is an n-dimensional CW complex, I usually think about manifolds, but there's really nothing involving manifolds here. It's an if or something. Yeah, assuming you have this, then the conclusion is that the degree must be a power of 2. All right. So the reason why this is a generalization of this theorem is that, you know, if you have this cohomology structure, then clearly this element x induces isomorphisms from HD to H2D and from H2D to H3D. Because powers of x are the generators. Here, however, you know, you have a bunch of, in this case, you have a z2 in degree 0, a z2 in degree d, and a z2 in degree 2d, and then zeros in between. So what we allow is for these to be arbitrary, but then these ones are not quite arbitrary. They're given by, you know, like the, if you go over by 3, then that's isomorphic to this group. And moreover, the product structure is, you know, there's a specific isomorphism given.
I just want to keep up. Is there an if missing in that sentence?
Yeah, I'm being pretty sloppy. Yeah. If there exists an element like this, yeah, so you should think of this as the same kind of thing as x was back here, except now maybe this is messy, but then, you know, these are given by multiplication by x. And then, yeah, now I should make this lowercase t. Oh, you're really messing me up. I'm on camera, too. Okay.
We'll Photoshop that part.
Okay.
I can do it.
Yeah. If you accidentally delete the file, that's okay, too. So, yeah, on one hand, you could, you know, celebrate that this is a generalization of this theorem. An obvious question, though, is what about this? I've tried really hard to try to get this far too. So this is still a question I don't know the answer to. Let me phrase it like this: does Adam's argument, or, you know, does Adam's proof extend? To show that this power of 2 is just, again, 1, 2, 4, 8. So I want to mention some remarks on this. First remark is that, yes, it does for a certain class of spaces. And this is one of these artificial conditions that, well, maybe it's a real condition, but it's an artificial condition that I, you know, if we assume it, I can prove it. And the condition is, if you have a space such that the Steenrod square in degree I kills all elements of degree 2i. So I'll write it like this. The image of this group under this homomorphism is 0 for all I. All right? I'm not going to get into the details of what how this comes up, but this is one of these conditions that's automatically true if you assume you have all these zeros in between, as in this situation. If you have this condition, then you can do some work and see that in this situation, Adam's proof works line for line. It goes through.
What's an example of an X?
Yeah, so that's a great question. If an easy way to build one of these that has this sort of property is to take a product. I'll sneak in a number two here. An example of a periodic space is something like a Quaternionic projective space. And so this is, we would call this as having four periodic. And then if you just take a product with S2, then you know how products work with and cup products and Cartesian products. So the element in degree 4 here multiplied by this element gives you a generator in degree 6, and so you have isomorphisms. So you can put any two manifold here, any three manifold, same kind of thing. Those are kind of trivial examples, but those are also the only examples I know. Stuff like that. So the
HPN
whole thing
is HP2, you mean, perhaps?
Oh. Well, let's see. For the most part, it's okay if you allow this to keep going a little farther. So, yeah, like this N here wasn't necessarily. Is there an N back here?
Oh,
the N just
yeah,
has.
No, okay, I get it. I see what I was confused about. Okay.
Yeah, you know what? I didn't. But thanks. I should say something like D has to be pretty small relative to N. So something like. You just need N to be large enough so that you have this periodicity, so that all the groups are participating in this, in one of these isomorphisms.
See, what I'm confused about is that you put x cubed there, you killed x cubed, as opposed to x to the n or something.
That's a good point. Yeah, if I can just change this, then the theorem is that as long as q is big enough, what did I have there? 3? Yeah, so same theorem holds if you allow it to go up. Yeah. So the motivation is not really because we have interesting examples. The motivation is because this condition comes up in nature, among mathematicians. This comes up in nature. So this condition of periodic cohomology naturally is a subjective term in this. For now. So it comes up in at least two ways that I know of. One is that when you study free actions on a finite groups on spheres, their group cohomology is periodic. So it comes up in group cohomology. And Jin could tell you a lot more about this. So this comes up in the topological, I'll just say the space form problem, where you look at finite covering spaces where the universal cover is a sphere. Okay, now group cohomology, this is not really the same. This is kind of cheating because I usually think about the periodicity ending at some point, not continuing to go on forever. So I recognize that's cheating a little bit. This is interesting to me too, but the reason I started thinking about this was because it comes up in a surprising way in Riemannian geometry. So I'll say it comes up in Riemannian geometry via a theorem due to Wilking called the connectedness lemma. Some people have started to call this the connectivity lemma. I'm too shy to change his name for it. This is what he calls it in a paper. So this was in 2003. This was in a really important paper in Riemannian geometry, and I would love to tell you all about this, but it would probably take me a good 20 minutes. The basic idea is that if you have a Riemannian manifold with sectional curvature positive on all two planes, so I denote it like this, and symmetries, so large isometry group, then you know there are a few intermediate steps. What often happens is that you obtain highly connected inclusions of submanifolds inside other submanifolds. So I'll just say it's M for simplicity. You know, being pretty vague about what large isometry group means. The fact is there's lots of papers where large isometry group means different things. But it's a torus action or a Lie group of large dimension or something like that. And what the connectedness theorem tells you is that you get inclusions that are highly connected. And it's just a fun game now. So this is an exercise. If you assume that M is simply connected and closed, and the inclusion is N minus K connected, in the sense of inducing isomorphisms on homotopy groups up to that point, then K is small relative to N, let's say less than this to be safe, then what happens is basically all of the homology groups are the same as well, and all of the cohomology groups are the same. And so you apply Poincaré duality here, and you're allowed to apply Poincaré duality here because it's also simply connected by this. And when you just write it down, when you apply Poincaré duality to both spaces, there's a shift by K because the dimensions are off by K. All right? And you know, you write one of these diagrams, it takes about a minute. The conclusion is that the cohomology here is periodic in that precise sense up there, integrally. That's all I really want to say about that, but it's a beautiful set of ideas. And anyway, that's how you get this periodicity in these sorts of problems. And most of my work has actually been to study this condition by itself, and then to see what you know. So I proved this in my thesis, and to see what this sort of thing tells us back in the geometric setting. To give you an idea of where I'm coming from. Yeah. So question two, this will be remark four. So I mentioned question one.
Can I ask a stupid question about this? I forgot what these theorems say, but is the universal cover of M a sphere in this under these hypotheses? You said just under the curvature hypothesis?
Here?
I have positive sectional curvature manifold that doesn't necessarily have a sphere, that's universal cover?
That's correct. So I think you might be thinking of constant positive sectional curvature. That's
okay.
A classification.
I see.
The projective spaces, in general. Yeah, so these are called the rank one projective spaces. Yeah, these all admit metrics called the Beam and Studi metrics.
Yeah,
so these have positive sectional curvature. That's basically it, though. They're not classified. But in dimensions above, what is it? Dimensions above 24, these are the only known simply connected examples. One of these fields where we don't have any examples to look at. So I want to just advertise another question here, which I don't know, is probably easy to the right person, but I don't know the answer. So the smallest potential counterexample to question one give you a CW complex. It's something, first question one. Yeah, so it's going to be a CW complex, which is periodic in this sense. And its period is going to be a power of 2, 16. It's going to be 16 periodic, but I don't know how to prove that it's in fact periodic. I call it a potential counterexample because I don't know how to build a CW complex. So let me say it like this. Has the cohomology given like this? So the 40, yeah, if it's a manifold, that's the dimension. CW complex is just the highest cell. So it's something that looks like this. It has two generators, one in degree 8, one in degree 16. And the generator in degree 8 squares to 0, and the generator in degree 16 is third power equal to 0. So if I, let me see. Yeah, so it looks like in degree 0, like that, 8, 16, 24, 32. So it's very simple looking, except there's one more thing I need to tell you. Is that the action of the Cnard algebra on this is non-trivial in the following sense. Square 8 takes this element of degree 16 to that element of degree 24. Right. So on one hand, I would be thrilled if someone said, yeah, here's a CW complex that has this cohomology ring and this Cnard algebra structure. Because that would mean, in a sense, that this extra strange condition I wrote down is actually, you know, that this actually is needed. But anyway, these are basic questions that I don't know the answer.
Oh, is that Cnard square there because if it weren't there, it would violate that result?
Yeah, so this is square 8 on each 16, yeah.
And so the question is whether there exists a CW complex with this cup product and Cnard algebra structure.
Exactly, yeah, and so this is an example of a topological realization problem. Is there a CW complex? But yeah, just as you said. Of course, you know, maybe I'm really interested in manifolds. That would make the question harder. But yeah, it's a bit baffling to me. And I didn't say this either, but you know, I like to advertise this condition because maybe it's something that comes up in other settings. It seems really strong and specific, and it is. It tells you a lot, but I don't know. Maybe it comes up in other areas. Any other questions about this?
If one exists, is it sort of homotopically unique? Does that this data nail it down to homotopic events?
I was thinking about the answer is no. So I was thinking about what the integer cohomology would look like, and there's some freedom there. Yeah.
And Dem and Smith had something called periodic cohomology. Was it the same thing, or was it just related?
Yeah, there what happens is you have, so with group cohomology, you're talking about, you know, BG, where G is the group, and so the cohomology is infinite dimensional. And so for them, this condition, it's basically the case that you allow the periodicity to continue forward forever. This is some kind of finite dimensional version. And when I say this also, I usually say Z2 cohomology is periodic or whatever, but I've read their condition to try to absorb it, and for them it's something very strong. It's for all coefficients you have this. I'm really intrigued by the connection, but I really haven't been able to explore it much.
This all examples then there's a remarkable one. When D less than or equal, when A less than or equal to 3.
Oh, here?
You remark 1, and the square, the stereo square condition, there's no examples.
Square 1, 2. Oh, that's, okay, so, these are actually not, this is actually not relevant to this because this is already four periodic, and that's the conclusion I'm trying to show here. So what I'm saying here is that, if it's 16, if it's 16 periodic but not four periodic, then that's a problem. I don't know if that helped. Actually, square one and H2 being non-trivial. Yeah, there should be examples like that, actually. Maybe we can chat after. I know I didn't answer that. Answer your question. So I'll move on to Q cohomology. So in a sense, this should be easier. Torsion is not something we like to talk about too much. Well, okay, me personally. And I want to motivate it by a question that Paul Corray asked as soon as he defined Betty numbers. This was in 1895. So he asked the question, given a sequence that looks like a sequence of Betty numbers for a manifold, connected manifold that's closed and orientable, such that each of these is a non-zero integer, such that Poincaré duality holds. Okay, so and there's one more extra condition that again follows from Poincaré duality, that that the middle Betty number is even. If n is of the form 4k plus 2, okay. So if the dimension is 4k plus 2, then the middle Betty number is odd by Poincaré duality because you get a skew symmetric non-degenerate bilinear form. So if you have a sequence of integers that looks like the Betty number sequence of a manifold, then is there a manifold? Realizing that. And so we're talking about Poincaré duality, so we're talking about a closed orientable manifold. The question is there a manifold realizing these Betty numbers? Okay, I'm calling the Betty numbers already, but whose Betty numbers are those? That's the question. And I don't know how much Poincaré knew about this, but a student in an algebraic topology class can pretty quickly answer almost every case. So the answer is that every sequence is realized. Dimension is not congruent to 0 mod 4, and the reason is because you can just construct things like a product of two spheres. You know, something like S1 times Sn minus 1 has a 1 here, and then it has a 1 here, and then a bunch of zeros in between. This would be one of your building blocks. And by taking other spheres, you can bring those ones in a little bit more. And those are, in a sense, like your irreducible pieces, and you can add up from there by taking connected sums. By constructing connected sums, of products of two spheres. All right. The same holds in dimensions divisible by 4 if that middle Betti number is even. So what you want to do is take the product of Sn over 2 times Sn over 2. That's pretty good. But that has Betti number 2 in the middle. So by taking connected sums, you can get 2, 4, 6, and so on. But the problem is that what about dimensions divisible by 4? And middle Betti number equal to 1. So if you can produce Betti number equal to 1 in the middle, then again, by adding products of spheres 2, you can get 3 and 5 and all the others. And so really, more specifically, this is the question, does there exist a manifold dimension n with, of course, B0 equal to 1, so Bn over 2 equal to 1, and Bn equals to 1. This is somehow as close as you can get to a rational sphere. This is just one step higher, and all other Betti numbers 0. So I don't know if I told you enough. I think I said it all in some order, that if you can produce a manifold like this in dimension n, then you can realize all possible sequences of Betti numbers. So this is a question that Sue worked on in her thesis. And I was, in part based on this other stuff, very interested in it. So it's a realization question. You know, fix a dimension, is there a manifold like this? So just to give some terminology for the next 20 minutes, we say that a manifold, and let's specify a little more. So simply connected closed manifold. We talk about smooth manifolds, so you could ask this for smooth manifolds or topological manifolds. I'm not sure if there's a difference. Somebody in this room knows the answer to that. Manifold M with these Betti numbers. And I want to point out that if you have these Betti numbers, that's an equivalent statement to say that the rational cohomology is singly generated. Something to give you the top class of concrete duality. The only something is itself, and you know, rationally it doesn't matter what multiple you take. So the top class is top group looks like x squared. So if all these things are rational projective plane, or this is a little more concise, kind of confusing but kind of cute. QP2. So this the name and the notation is motivated by the rank 1 projective space is CP2 as this rational cohomology ring, HP2, and the Cayley plane. These are in dimensions 4, 8, and 16. The question as of, I guess, about 5 years ago was, a few years ago was you know, what other dimensions have these manifolds? And I want to point out that one obstruction is the Hirzebruch signature theorem. So these manifolds, because their middle Betti number is 1, must have signature 1. That's a change in orientation. And the signature theorem tells you that, you know, if it's a smooth manifold, then its Pontryagin eigenclasses have to satisfy the Hirzebruch signature theorem. And that's a condition. Maybe there are no possible choices of Pontryagin eigenclasses to make that work. And so Sarah used this just as a comment. This was in the 50s, to say that there does not exist one of these creatures in dimensions 12 or 20. So again, we're talking about dimensions divisible by 4, and this fills out the theory up to dimension 20. And in the proof, again, you write down the Hirzebruch signature formula. The signature is 1. All right. The signature, according to this theorem, is what you get when you plug in the Pontryagin classes to the L polynomial and evaluate. And you get a little lucky, so I'm talking about dimension 12, so this one must be 0, this one must be 0. And so you just end up evaluating a certain coefficient of this polynomial against, and I memorized this one for the talk.
Don't look.
Yeah, 62 is on top, and it's 900 something. And it's got to be co-prime, and I don't want to try that in my head. P3. It looks like this, and the important thing is that this is an integer. So even if you're not good at number theory like me, you can still see, well, put the 945 over here, that, you know, the 62 must divide 945, okay? And it doesn't if I wrote it down correctly. Okay, so that's, this is a contradiction. The assumption was that there exists such a thing, so there's no space like that in dimension as well.
Okay. So you're saying for 24, that argument doesn't work?
24.
You have some
8, 3.
It's a multiple of 8.
An extension of that argument will work, but that's a paper that's more recent.
No, I just mean this argument.
Oh yeah.
You write down a formula for the L polynomial, and the fact that,
oh, I see what you mean.
That lots of stuff is vanishes because your cohomology is 0.
So. Oh yeah, is it?
Sarah
just
wasn't lazy.
No,
this is all his argument with you. That's my question.
Oh, that's a good question.
Look, 24, you have middle, you have P6, P3.
Yes.
It's not just one. It's not just the top one.
So yeah, this argument doesn't work here. That's right, yeah, because, so here P1 and P2 are 0. There, yeah, P6. Of course, you're plugging in all of them, but what's different about this case is that you could have two of them be non-zero. So you get something, instead of like this, you would get, that's a good point. So dimension 24.
I'm confused. How can you have two of them be non-zero?
P3 cubed and P6.
Yeah, so there's a coefficient like this, P3 cubed?
Sorry, squared.
Squared?
Right.
Make me do arithmetic.
Oh,
on P6, the board here.
Yeah, okay, I see.
And
okay,
P6. Yeah, so this was analogous to this term. This is a top piece. But here, because the dimension is divisible by 8, that means the middle one is divisible by 4. So there's a Pontryagin class there, yeah.
And use smoothness to say this is an integer. For topological manifolds, it's not necessarily an integer.
Okay. So by smoothness, these are integers. And then these a and b are, again, you know, some terrible rational numbers, but it's definitely harder now to say that no such thing exists. Yeah.
But no such thing exists.
Did I say it backwards?
No, you said it's harder to say that no such thing exists. And I was trying to extend or complete your sentence saying, but no such thing exists.
Oh, that's correct. Yeah, so let me get to something.
Sorry, I want to ask just a
sure.
Elementary school question, but is 12 and 20 the only case where only one of these Pontryagin classes is non-zero?
No, so this is something Sue showed in her thesis she showed more, but one consequence was that anything that's of the form, yeah, it is an elementary, 8k plus 4.
Yeah, has that property.
Has this property.
But then the rational number may not be.
Would not work.
As long as the numerator is not 1.
Numerator not 1, that's correct. Yeah, you have to figure out what this is. But
I was on our committee, so.
So this was published in 14. So, I'll just use this notation to be brief. So there does not exist one of these creatures in any dimension, AK plus 4. Of course, dimension 4 had CP2, so this is the first two dimensions Sarah considered, but actually the argument works more. Of course, I don't know what Sarah was thinking. I mean, I wish I did in many times, but you have to be able to figure out a little bit about that coefficient. Yeah, I guess the numerator is not allowed to be 1. That would do it.
Actually, 50 pretty early, so it's good.
Yeah,
It's before the Hertzsprung signature theorem.
Oh, it was? Oh, that is really.
Well, it depends what you mean by that. If you want some formula for the coefficients, that's the Hertzsprung signature theorem. So Sarah probably knew some other dimensional cases.
Oh, okay. Thanks. That makes more sense. Yeah. So. I should say, so this is one obstruction. So further obstructions, so really the obstructions are completely understood, and this is due to Barge and Sullivan. They showed that, so the signature theorem, so let me say it like this. Yeah, the signature theorem plus some conditions I'm not going to write down, the Hori-Stom conditions. So these have to be integers. The gravity conditions are both necessary and sufficient for the existence of these spaces. Now, their theorem is much more general, and if you're familiar with this is something about if you have something which walks and talks like a rational cohomology ring, then they show that it is, assuming you can choose formal Pontryagin classes that are integral, that satisfy the signature theorem, and then these somewhat more mysterious conditions. So Sue studied these. In the case of a QP2, let's just write Sue now, and showed that actually you can work out the coefficients and find that there's you might think that there is no further example, in light of Adam's theorem. The geometric examples were the only examples in the Z2 cohomology case. But rationally, there are exotic examples. So there is one of these creatures in dimension 32. All right. So there's some further work. There's a paper by Sue and Jim Fowler. And then I'm just going to combine some statements here. I've also been working with Sue. There are some further examples. So you might guess the next. So remember, the classical examples are 4, 8, and 16. Sue found one in 32.
Are they simply connected?
Yes. Did I say that somewhere? Yeah.
Is that part of your definition?
Yeah. Up
oh,
here,
yes.
Up here. Yeah. Yeah, so dimension 2 is not. Yeah. Well, it's, anyway. Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, if we're all good mathematicians, we would guess 64 is the next case. But the statement here, this is due to Jim and Sue, there does not exist an example in dimension 64. And they looked at 128 and couldn't figure out, maybe this is the point where it stops. But it's really mysterious. So you can actually find an example in the next power of 2 and the one after that. Okay? But there does not exist an example in dimension 512. Right. So I'm just recording what we know so far. And I don't know what really to say about it. There are examples up to 32, then the answer is no, then the answer is yes, and yes again, and then no again. We still don't know whether there are infinitely many dimensions that support a QP2. We do know that there are infinitely many dimensions which are a power of 2. So there's a lot to say about numbers, dimensions that aren't powers of 2, but let me restrict to these for now in the interest of time. What we can show is that there are infinitely many dimensions that are powers of 2 where there's no QP2. So there's infinitely many dimensions of 2 that do not support QP2. All right. And what am I doing? You guys go to about 20 after, or do you go through? Okay. So I will have a little bit of time. I probably won't get much of the geometric models part of my talk, but I think it's okay. So, because I want to discuss a little bit about this. So part of what Sue did that was so valuable is to understand this theorem and to write it in language that someone like I can understand. So we worked on this, and there's two or three basic steps. The first is to show that the first two of these conditions, the Hattori-Stong integrality conditions, show that these two conditions imply all of the others. And there's approximately dimension squared of them. So there's an n or a k somewhere, depending on your notation. And if it's k, then there's about k squared of these conditions. And we showed that actually, if you pick the first two of them, so the statement is, if those are integers, then so are the other things. So this simplified the existence question. And step two then was to say, so you have now just two conditions. So the first two Hattori-Stong conditions, if you combine these then with the symmetry equation, so on one hand, by Barge and Sullivan, this is equivalent to the existence of a QP2 in some fixed dimension. All right, so this is equivalent to all the Hattori-Stong and symmetry equation. We show that's equivalent to the first two Hattori song in the signature equation. All right. So step two is to show that these two things together are equivalent to a single equation. And okay, this part is just we have three equations, two unknowns. Two of the equations are really integrality conditions, so you just make a change of variables to eliminate two of the conditions. This is nothing deep here. None of this bottom. Single equation of the form ax squared plus bky equals ck, where x and y are your integer variables. These are your Pontryagin numbers that come up in this set. So these are integers. And these are your unknowns that you want to solve for. The statement is that there exists a QP2 if and only if there are integer solutions to these equations. And these ak, bk, ck, the k is for the dimension. I haven't been saying anything about the dimension, but we're fixing a dimension. And these are...
What is the dimension?
The dimension's 8k. So let me say it like this. The dimension 8k. So remember, there's dimensions 8k plus 4. There's no examples. So we let k be this, so that it's dimension 8k. And so we have a single equation. This looks not too hard. The problem with solving it is that that these numbers depend on Bernoulli numbers. And these are the numbers which show up when you start adding up the first n integers and the first n squares and the first n cubes. And you might wonder, well, is there a nice formula for the sum of the first n kth powers? However, the numbers are terrible. They grow very fast. They're rational numbers. The denominators of them are completely understood, but the numerators are just a mess. In fact, there's something called an irregular prime. This is something I learned in all this. An irregular prime is a prime which divides one of these numerators. All right, and you know, number theorists study things like, are there infinitely many irregular primes? What percentage of primes are irregular? I think the claim is that, an open question is whether there's infinitely many regular primes, which are the ones that are not irregular. I'm just saying all this not because I know anything about it, but just to say that, you know, these are not just easy equations to solve, because when you start to try to solve these, you reduce mod p, of course, for various primes, and you don't even know what the primes are because these Bernoulli numbers are so terrible. Okay. In small dimensions, you can analyze what they are. The reason we can't go past 512 is simply that the Bernoulli numbers at that point, or past that point, don't have factorizations. So
there are counterexamples to Euclid's theorem.
What's that?
There are counterexamples to Euclid's theorem that every number factors into a product of primes.
Oh, yeah. So many people's computers think so. Yeah. Since I have 5 minutes, I guess I should first ask if there are any questions about this. I wanted to just advertise one other problem. So
this number three here is a consequence of this together with some known facts about a number theory.
Oh, yes. All right. Yeah, that's right. This theorem's a little different. So one of the things that's known is it uses something called the Kummer congruences. Yeah, these are general statements of the form if the kth Bernoulli number is divisible by p, then so are some other ones. There's infinite families of them divisible by p. And so if you know something about a small Bernoulli number, you're able to say something about the higher ones. And this is Yeah, so without buried in the details, this is good enough to obstruct dimensions, but not good enough to
realize,
yeah. Yeah. So okay. Yeah, and so we have specific families of dimensions. In fact, 64, I can write it like the 64 to the k is one, or k is bad. 64 to the n is one family of dimensions that do not support these things. I think I planned too much to say, so I'm not going to go on. I'll just mention that something I've been really interested in is to try to understand the geometry of an example like this. So one thing you might want to do is to put a Riemannian metric on it. After all, it's a smooth manifold. You might ask, what sort of metrics does it admit? Okay, Einstein metrics, you know, metrics of bounded curvature. That seems hard because you have no idea what it looks like. So a better question, I think, is to ask if these admit nice models, in a sense. For example, are any of these homogeneous spaces? If they're homogeneous, then it becomes easier to define things like metrics on them. And the short answer is no. None of these QP2s that exist admit transitive group actions. And the proof of that is, well, there's more basic proofs, but sort of the cleanest, nicest proof is using rational homotopy theory. These things have very simple rational homotopy theory, and that plays well with Lie groups and homogeneous spaces. So those concepts play well with each other. And this is not our theorem. This is an older theorem that this, for example, does not admit a transitive Lie group action. What I've studied more recently is more general geometries. There's things called biquotients and cohomogeneity one structures. These can be seen as generalizations of homogeneous structures. So okay, it's not homogeneous, but it can it be the next best thing? And again, the answer is no. So you know, it's one of these very disappointing things. There's various classifications here, but the short story is that this manifold and these ones, these QP2s that we know exist, they, you know, if you pick any particular one, it doesn't have much symmetry. That's the short story. Yeah, so. Okay, thank you very much for your time.